Okay, here we go. Stand by. 3, 2, 1, action.
Assume nothing.
Rash, bald-faced blasphemy.
Question everything.
I find it extremely hard to imagine.
Open your eyes.
It is quite all right to be an atheist.
The fastest growing group of people in the country has been measured as being those who have no belief or who are atheists.
You don't have to be apologetic or quiet about it.
Challenge the opposition.
You see religion on 100 fronts losing the argument.
And start thinking. This is The Thinking Atheist Worldwide.
Today's broadcast is brought to you by NatureBox, with over 100 fun, delicious, and smarter snacks made with healthier ingredients that are delivered right to your doorstep. And of course, your very first box is on them if you've never tried them. So log on to naturebox.com/thinkingatheist and taste the goodness. naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. On today's show, the transgender question will feature some of your input. I've gotten some emails in from our listeners, and the bulk of the show will consist of a very special panel of transgender individuals who are going to weigh in and give us a first-hand perspective about what transgender is and what it means. I had a concerned message on the Facebook page last week from someone named Leslie who was like, please don't make this a circus. I think that's not exactly what she said, but it was the gist. You know, please, there's so many people who get this stuff wrong. There's so much tabloid out there. It's just such a circus, so many misconceptions. And of course, then prejudice can be built upon those misconceptions. I hope that you will approach this subject respectfully. And Leslie, you have my word. That is exactly what we want to do tonight. On next week's broadcast, we're going to talk about the butterfly effect. I'm just fascinated by this kind of thing. We'll talk a little bit about chaos theory and get into a little bit of what the science of it means. But that's not really going to be the bulk of the show. Kind of a clinical classroom about chaos theory. No, not so much. I'm interested in the human stories. I want to hear how something that, well, it seemed like it was nothing at the time, just an inconsequential event, something innocuous, something to be forgotten immediately. You didn't realize it, but it somehow changed the trajectory of your entire life or someone else's life. You know, you turn a corner and bump into someone and that person changes your life. You take a right turn instead of a left turn. And you end up in a place or circumstance you never, ever would have dreamed possible, and it changed everything. You took a seat on the bus next to somebody. You clicked a link on YouTube, and a video changed your perception about something critical. This is what happened to me. I'm just cruising along, killing time, doing some graphics work. Click a Christopher Hitchens video. Before I know it, that particular video, that one debate, just propelled me on a journey of probably hundreds of other clips online. What would my life be like if I hadn't clicked that link at that one time? You know, would I be an activist today? Would I have found my escape from religion? Or even if I did, would it have been the same type of journey? Would I be at a whole other place in my life? The butterfly effect. If you've got a story in your own life, and it doesn't have to be about atheism or religion, it can be about anything. This is going to be a human stories kind of show. Send it in an email to podcast@thethinkingatheist.com and get it in before next Tuesday, okay? Let me digress very quickly before we get into the show topic tonight, because we're doing something really good for this guy who has escaped a cult. The short story goes like this. Tracy Lockwood is a friend of mine. She had escaped a cult. She calls it the Brotherhood cult. It's kind of her nickname for it. And the environment she escaped from was hugely oppressive, where the kids weren't really educated. They were more indoctrinated. People were virtually stripped of their identities. Don't even get me started on how women were perceived and treated inside this group. And finally, Tracy busted out and found herself alone and completely unprepared for the world around her. And she managed to get on her feet and start the next chapter of her life. And now she's an activist. In fact, you may have seen her speak at the American Atheist National Convention in 2014. And that speech is on YouTube. So she's out doing some good and trying to help some people. Well, apparently there's this 19-year-old guy who's also escaped from the very same cult. I mean, just as in days ago. And he's in a homeless shelter right now in Missouri with two pair of jeans, a shirt and a pair of boots, and maybe a couple of bucks in his pocket. He's got nothing. And he's trying to figure out what happens next. And so what we are doing as humanists is we're coming to his aid and saying, all right, we're going to give you a hand. We're going to get you some money to buy basic necessities. Tracy is going to keep all of those expenses accountable and make the expense record available here in the next few weeks, because she, like Hemley Gonzalez over at Responsible Charity and so many others, believe in accountability with these donations. But they're going to give him a fresh start and allow him a little bit of a boost as he begins this next chapter of his life. And it looks like there may be some other kids who were seeking to escape as well. And so she has set up a GoFundMe page called Help Kids Leaving Cults. And the page has already raised several hundred dollars on his behalf. And if you would like to be a part of the next chapter of his life, providing at least basic necessities while he kind of gets his bearings and tries to figure out what's going to happen next, I think it would be a worthy thing to be able to do so. And again, I will include the link to that page in the description box of this show. On tonight's show, we're talking about the transgender question. And we'll begin that discussion here in just a second. Allow me, my friends, to introduce you to the double berry fruit peels, the sourdough cheddar pretzels, the guacamole bites, the cranberry almond bites, the dark cocoa nom noms, the praline pumpkin seeds, just a few of over 100 delicious Nature Box options that can be delivered right to your doorstep, full of flavor, without all the junk. And new snack options offered up every single month, so you're never going to get bored. Something new all the time. And of course, there's the Smart Snack Guarantee. So if there's ever anything that doesn't strike your fancy, just let them know. They'll replace it in your next month's box. Right now, you can enjoy your very first Nature Box on them. So log on to the website and just browse it for a few. I think you're going to enjoy yourself. It's naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. Unbox the taste, unbox the possibilities. naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. Jazz Jennings was born on the 6th of October, 2000. Jazz Jennings is an American teenage trans girl. She's a popular YouTube figure, a spokesmodel, and an LGBTQ rights activist. Jennings is one of the youngest publicly documented people to be identified as a gender dysphoric person. Dysphoria, by the way, is a profound state of unease or dissatisfaction. She's been interviewed by Barbara Walters on 2020. She's an honorary co-founder of the Trans Kids Purple Rainbow Foundation, which she started with her parents. On the About section of her YouTube channel, she says this, quote, "My name is Jazz, and I was assigned male at birth, but happily live as a girl. My channel shows that transgender people are just like everyone else, and that we have to embrace our differences to create freedom and equality for all." Jazz Jennings, the recent star of a reality TV series. Now in the 9th grade, Jazz plans to undergo sex realignment surgery at 18, having been born male, but living as a female since she was 5. An article just came out in the National Review, which is a popular conservative magazine. It published July 7th, written by David French, who said this, "The story of Jazz is among the most disturbing stories of the week." As I skip down into the article, David French says this, quote, "As the reality TV world gets set to celebrate a child who's planning to mutilate his body when he turns 18, I recall this haunting story from the New York Times, recounting the story of Kat, a young man desperately trying to be a woman. It was too late to change some things, like Kat's tenor voice and facial hair. Quote, I hate my voice, she said. I shave. She chose not to save sperm, to her a revolting reminder of masculinity. So she cannot have children. The one sacrifice that gave her father a pang. The operation involved deconstructing her male genitals and repurposing the nerves and skin as female anatomy. When it was over, Kat developed aspiration pneumonia and had vomiting and dry heaves for days. Normal reactions to anesthesia, narcotics, and antibiotics, but Dr. McGinn said Kat was hit harder than most. Before the surgery, she had been impish and playful. Now she buried her nose in her Nintendo 3DS and cracked a rare smile at an old text message consisting entirely of meow, meow. Her father felt helpless as she refused food and lost about 20 pounds. Dr. McGinn said it was not unusual for patients to become depressed after surgery and compared this to postpartum depression. Kat was anxious about having enough privacy in college since her new vagina needs constant care or it will close off like a wound. Quote, "The only thing I'm thinking about now is the room situation." This is the future that our new culture is proclaiming for troubled kids, a future of genitals that are like wounds, and suicide rates that skyrocket beyond all reason, more than 19 times that of the general population. After being put forward to the world as a transgender child celebrity, how free will Jazz Jennings be to pull back from the brink? In a world of red carpets, fame, and acclaim, who will tell Jazz the truth? There was a Facebook post sent to me, I think today. Matt Dillahunty commented on it. It was posted by Emily Danielson. It was addressed to Caitlyn Jenner. It said this, "I've heard you say you, quote, identify as a woman, but I find that highly unlikely and insulting. You see, Mr. Jenner, there's more to being a woman than beautiful gowns and fake boobs. There's more to being a woman than makeup and pretty hair. This is something we mothers begin teaching our young daughters at an early age. As a woman of nearly 50 years, I can tell you what it's truly like to be a woman. You may be able to understand or even empathize, but you're definitely not able to identify. For instance, you'll never know what it's like to wake up every 28 days with searing stomach pain so bad it doubles you over, yet you still trot off to work or school as though everything's fine. You'll never know what it's like to have your car break down on the side of the road, and when a couple men stop to help you, your prayer is that their intentions are good because there's no way on earth you have the ability to physically hang, let alone overpower them. You have no idea what it's like to long to have a child, only to have your third miscarriage, yet still manage to be able to share in the joy of all the other young mothers in your life. You'll never know what it's like to get pregnant, gain 40 pounds, a third of your total body weight, hurl all morning long for 4 months straight, yet still care for your other two toddlers and not drive your husband to the brink. You'll never know what it's like to give birth to a 10-pound baby boy with absolutely no medication. You'll never know what it's like at the age of 50 to be walking down the streets of Phoenix and popping in the Dairy Queen for a cool, refreshing treat, only to be gripped at that moment with your fourth hot flash of the day. I have in my life met many women who have been widowed. For me to walk up to them and say I identify with them would be ludicrous. Like I said earlier, I can empathize with them, but I cannot identify myself as one of them because I don't know what it's like. I can only imagine. And let's not even talk about women who have worked through their double mastectomy. No, Mr. Jenner, there's more to being a woman than you could ever experience or even imagine. And lesson number one for all true women is this: Botox injections, plastic surgeries, designer clothing, and public approval is not, all caps, not what makes a woman. A real woman is one who, in spite of the stretch marks, age spots, dirt under her nails, and tired eyes, and even with plastic photoshopped supermodels as her competition, she's carried herself in such a way that her family, husband, and children see her real beauty and find her more valuable than rubies or diamonds, and they rise up and call her blessed. Mr. Jenner, you are a privileged white male living in the USA. In fact, you are so free and so privileged, you could even spend your massive amounts of money to change your outward appearance to whatever you wished. This is not something most women around the globe are free to do, even if they wanted. Most women in our world don't even have access to a high school education. So, Mr. Jenner, I find your claim to identify as a woman disingenuous, uneducated, and honestly, quite offensive. And again, that is a Facebook post from Emily Danielson, I think was posted sometime this week. What is transgender? From the website of GLAAD, the Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation website says this: transgender, adjective, an umbrella term for people whose gender identity and or gender expression differs from what is typically associated with the sex they were assigned at birth. People under the transgender umbrella may describe themselves using one or more of a wide variety of terms, including transgender. Some of these terms are defined here, and they have it on the website. Use the descriptive term preferred by the individual. Many transgender people are prescribed hormones by their doctors to change their bodies. Some undergo surgery as well, but not all transgender people can or will take those steps. And a transgender identity is not dependent upon medical procedures. From the wiki page, a transgender individual may have characteristics that are normally associated with a particular gender and identify elsewhere on the traditional gender continuum or exist outside of it as other: agender, gender neutral, gender queer, non-binary, third gender, etc. Transgender people may also identify as bi-gender, pan-gender, or along several places on either the traditional transgender continuum or the more encompassing continuums that have been developed in response to recent, significantly more detailed studies. Furthermore, many transgender people experience a period of identity development that includes better understanding of one's self-image, self-reflection, and self-expression. More specifically, the degree to which individuals feel genuine, authentic, and comfortable within their external appearance and accept their genuine identity is referred to as transgender congruence. All right, that's a mouthful, right? All these terms flying around: non-binary, pangender, gender queer. Terms that seem like a foreign language to those who have been raised with the strict pat definitions of gender, right? Male, female. That's it. We begin to see the complexities of sexual identity. How do we define it? How to describe it? How do we understand it? How to proceed with that understanding? Well, this broadcast tonight is about understanding. And I've assembled a wonderful panel of people who can help us explore this discussion. Zinnia Jones is a writer and YouTuber. Her work has been downloaded millions of times, and it focuses largely on secularism, feminism, and being transgender. ZJ, glad you're here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Stephanie Guttormson is operations director with the Richard Dawkins Foundation for Reason and Science. Stephanie hosts her own YouTube channel, Think Stephtically. Steph made headlines just recently when a faith healer that she had publicly criticized filed a lawsuit against her. We're going to get to that story here in just a second. Yeah, I know it's a little off topic, but I have to know what happened. Stephanie, thanks for being on the radio. Great to have you.
Absolutely wonderful to be here. Thank you, Seth.
Callie Wright is one of the hosts of the Gaytheist Manifesto radio podcast, which handles issues, quote, at the intersection of LGBT rights and atheism, secularism. Callie, glad you're here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me.
And finally, Danielle Muscato spent a whole lot of years as public relations director for American Atheist. As a writer, public speaker, and full-time activist today, Danielle officially joined this conversation in November of last year with an article on Pathos titled, "Today I'm Saying Goodbye to My Old Self." Danielle, welcome to the broadcast.
Thanks for having me on.
Danielle, I first met you when you were Dave Muscato. Is that weird? You know, is it weird to have somebody address you differently using a different first name in conversations? You know, people who've known you for years or even your whole life. Has that been an odd transition?
Yes and no. Some people still call me Dave. My grandmother doesn't. She's 100 years old, literally. So I haven't really tried to explain this to her. My legal name is still David. So, a lot of, you know, bank statements and things like that still come in the mail to me that way. But all my friends and my family call me Danielle, and it feels much more comfortable to me to be addressed as that.
You know, many times when I ask a question on the radio, sometimes I'll already sort of know the answer, but I'm asking the question to further the conversation, and because I think many people in the audience are hoping I will ask the question. And then there are a lot of times when I ask the question because I honestly am ignorant and I do not know, and I want to know more about this tomorrow than I did yesterday. And I think the audience joins me on that journey as well. This broadcast fits that description. I only ask that if I accidentally say something that is wrongly stated or is accidentally disrespectful, I certainly hope it doesn't happen, but if I couch something incorrectly, or hopefully not offensively, but if it comes out of my mouth wrong, just know that it came from a position of I am learning as I go, and I respectfully want to understand this very complex issue. And you guys be free to correct me on anything I might get wrong on the radio today, okay?
Sounds good. Yeah.
Okay. You can count on me.
Well, let's talk about it. I mean, you guys heard the monologue about Jazz, the sort of teen star, and everybody's been watching the Jenner thing and all the tabloids and whatnot. And you heard the words of the article from David French in the National Review and the Facebook rebuttal to Caitlyn Jenner. And what's going on in your mind? I'll let anybody who wants to start, just let me know who I'm listening to before you sound off.
This is Callie. So, It kind of comes from two different sides, because there are parts of that second Facebook post that are accurate, talking about Caitlyn Jenner's privilege, because so many trans people deal with things like homelessness, poverty, lack of access to even basic healthcare, like not even trans-related healthcare, but basic healthcare, that, you know, that image of, I did an interview with Diane Sawyer and now my transition is complete months later, can be kind of problematic for trans people. But at the same time, there's all kinds of stuff in there about, like, you know, if a woman has a hysterectomy, is she less of a woman? Because if you follow that post's logic, that's what she's saying. So there's just lots of really problematic ideas about, you know, you can't be a woman unless. So it's really frustrating, because I mean, you could write a PhD dissertation on the things that that trans people go through, with, I mean, even the references to sexual assault, references to violence and all that sort of stuff. So I mean, there are a myriad of issues in this whole thing.
ZJ, you want to weigh in?
I would say that those two articles just have some of the most selective and narrow perspectives on this. I mean, consider the perspective of David French. He seems to think that nobody at all is willing to say, you know, discourage children from transitioning, from living as their genders, when the reality is that there are massive social forces at work discouraging trans people from being who they are, obstructing our ability to access necessary treatments, and especially in the case of children. That is an incredibly difficult thing. He's trying to position himself as representing some sort of minority perspective against this just massive cultural force, when really it's the reverse of that. And that Facebook post as well, the description of her experiences and the way that she applies them, her assumption here is that these are things that somehow apply to all cis women, but apply to no trans women. The reality is much more complex than that. Many of her experiences are not shared by cis women. Many of her experiences are shared by trans women. And this underlying assumption of requiring complete similarity to a person's whole collection of life experiences, or else one is just not legitimately a woman, is just preposterous. That just makes no sense whatsoever. You know, trans women experience many of the things she talked about. Trans women are often in great danger from men. Trans women experience alienation from their families. Many trans women have children. Many cis women have plastic surgery, believe it or not. And the selectivity in using all of this to just invalidate trans women's genders is extremely short-sighted.
When you say cis women, you're talking about what? Someone who maintains the sexual identity they were assigned when they were born?
Yes. For instance, women who were assigned female at birth and continue to identify as women.
Stephanie, anything to add?
One thing I wanted to point out is that where was this post about Chaz Bunner not being a real man? Where are all those experiences about being a man that Chaz will never experience? You never saw that post, right? Never. It's interesting that a lot of the animosity gets thrown at trans women rather than trans men. That might just be because we're trans women, and that's what we see all the time. We could be biased, is all I'm saying. But I don't see the same animosity that way. And as far as the hate monger guy, what was his name? David something?
Oh, David French from the National Review.
Yeah, David French, I think he's on a mission to make us out to be predators. And he was essentially setting up the groundwork for that and also calling sexual reassignment surgery mutilation.
Yeah,
mutilation. Is entirely outrageous. Entirely outrageous. Like, it's not even worth going past that. And as far as the other woman, the Facebook post, I had saw that post days and days and days ago. And I'm going to say what I said in the comment section of that for the one that you posted, Seth, is that this woman made about the most misogynist comments about women that I've ever read. And I say that because she essentially reduced women to their physical bodies, more or less a walking vagina, simply because, as Zinnia was talking about, it's all these biological factors. It's all these very specific things that happen to her body or whatever. What about women who are sterile? They can't share in some of these things. So trying to disenfranchise trans women simply because they are different is a little bit annoying.
I'm not going to go to all four guests on the panel with every question, or we'll be here all night. But I do want to cover this pretty thoroughly. Danielle, anything to add on the Caitlyn Jenner thing, on the Jazz Jennings thing? What do you think?
I don't want to repeat everything that's already been said, but she's doing a lot of the same thing that a lot of people who are uninformed about transgender issues tend to do, which is confusing gender and sex. She's saying that what makes a woman is her genitals, and that's not true, and her biological makeup as far as her, you know, her sex. And that's not what transgender is about. Transgender is about your gender identity. And gender and sex are not interchangeable terms, and people tend to conflate them because they're not used to thinking of them as separate things. But they're very much separate things. And part of understanding what transgender people are and what that means is understanding that those are two distinct concepts.
So if you and I are having coffee and I say, fine, what makes a woman? How do you answer that question?
I think the best way to tell if somebody is a woman is how they self-identify. I mean, that's really the best answer. Genetically, there are certain differences between what a doctor would call a male versus a female, but there's a lot of variation even just between those two. It's not black and white, even remotely. And that's just genetics. I mean, there's also not a black and white answer to that looking at genitals, and there's not a black and white answer to that looking at the pitch of your voice, or a black and white answer to that looking at the breadth of your shoulders, or a black and white answer to that looking at height, or any of the other secondary sexual characteristics that differentiate biological men and biological women, to use, you know, some outdated terms. It's a spectrum in every single measure, and really the only surefire way to know is just to ask the person.
I had an email in from someone who said this: I believe wholeheartedly in gender irrelevance. I don't believe in wasting effort trying to fight for inclusion of the genders and sexualities, pushing the barrier 2 inches each decade and having it bounce back the next year. People are stupidly against certain genders and sexualities and levels of physical ability, and trying to change their mind there is useless. What I think would accomplish more is pushing a culture of relevance and focus. If people were trained to look at only relevant characteristics in each other, we would have equality. Any thoughts on that, anyone?
Well, I think that's assuming that someone's gender is irrelevant. I knew who I was before I'd internalized a lot of the messages that we get in culture about gender. You know, I mean, I could spend a lot of time going into the science, but there's a pretty well documented, at least there's things that are suggestive of at least somewhat of a biological basis for gender. And I mean, it matters enough to me that I'm willing to uproot my life and turn it upside down to do this. So, I mean, my gender's not irrelevant to me. I mean, I kind of wish it was, but it's not.
Well, Callie, take me back to when you identified or were handed a male identity. Are you in conflict? Are you going through that thing that we hear about where you're not comfortable in your own skin, you don't like who you see in the mirror, everything feels wrong. Is any of that going on?
Very much so. I mean, for me, it kind of started when I was like 10, like just at the beginning of puberty. Some people say like they know as soon as they're able to think. And for some people, it doesn't manifest until much later in life. There's a very wide spectrum of experience. But I remember very specifically sitting at the lunch table in fifth grade, and my best friend that I always ate lunch with wasn't there. So I was kind of hanging out by myself. And I noticed the way that my body was changing, and I noticed the way that girls' bodies were changing. And it kind of struck me all at once. Like, I was supposed to be a girl.
Are the students aware of this going on with you? Do they notice differences in you?
Oh, no. I never spoke a word about it until I was 28.
So to internalize all of that, you're in prison.
Oh, yeah, very much so.
Anybody else?
This is Stephanie. My experience is somewhat similar to Callie's, but different in a couple respects. I knew around the time that I was about 8 years old, so very close in age as far as like knowing. I kind of expressed it a little bit more assertively, and maybe people that know me wouldn't be surprised by that. But I was cross-dressing at a young age and heavily discouraged against doing that by my family. And, you know, I tried to push back against it and kept trying to push back against it in high school. And at 18, I finally told my mom, like, I'm a girl. And that's just a thing.
Mom says what?
Unfortunately, I want to preface what I'm about to say about her by saying that she totally loves me and accepts who I am now. This is 10 years ago. I don't want any hate towards my mother at all. I'll make that clear.
Well, you can share as much or as little as you want to. If this is sort of private territory, me off.
I just want listeners to not think that my mom's a horrible person is all, because this is 10 years ago. And I told her that she tried a little bit, that much. And then, I just kept being discouraged. I didn't start transitioning until I was 27 when I moved out to Maryland for my job at RDF. And that was probably the most freeing experience kind of ever when I started transitioning. I wasn't in Maryland 2 months when I sought out what I needed to seek out for treatment. But as far as like the feelings that Callie was talking about, it's not only a prison, but the feeling of helplessness and not being able to like be yourself. It's almost indescribable, to be honest. Like, we try to say like, oh, we don't like who we like, you know, look like in the mirror, or we say things like, I'm in the wrong body, but that's probably the closest, you know, we can get to it, because the rest of those feelings are some of the most frustrating things. The amount of frustration that I was carrying around was extremely high. My mom will attest to that.
ZJ or Danielle, want to weigh in at all?
This is Zinnia. What the letter writer seems to be proposing, their perspective seems to kind of presuppose a kind of genderless utopia. But the reality is that gender is still considered pretty highly relevant by most of society, you know, for better or worse. And that makes it pretty difficult just to ignore that. I mean, we can try to do so, you know, of our own initiative, but people will impose that on us anyway. I mean, there was a period of my life where, when I was on YouTube, I didn't associate myself with any gender at all, but that didn't stop so many people from just trying to pin me down into one gender or another. And so we kind of have to recognize the terms that we're working on here when it comes to, you know, the state of society as it is before we can make, you know, meaningful progress on that front. And that is a goal that I do recognize, and I do encourage that, because these norms of which gender is allowed to do what or which gender should do what do not need to be in place. There's no need for such restrictions. But even without that, there are some biological aspects to being trans that would almost certainly persist, even in the case of gender as a concept being completely gone. I mean, when I started on hormone treatment, this was almost a purely medical thing for me, because I had already been living socially as a woman for some time. But hormones made a difference that I didn't even expect. It just caused this reduction in this anxiety and depression that I didn't even know I had, that I thought was normal, and it completely altered my concept of what life was supposed to feel like. So even if we do, you know, affect substantial changes to how gender is treated in society and hopefully becoming more and more irrelevant, which I agree with, there are still going to be aspects of this that trans people will have to deal with.
Danielle, remember at the American Atheist Convention, was it last year when they did the, was it genderless restrooms? I don't know if that's even the way we phrase it.
Yeah, they were set up as gender-neutral bathrooms.
Gender-neutral bathrooms, thank you.
Or, yeah, also called all-gender bathrooms.
Whose idea was that?
That was my idea and Nick Fish's idea, which we borrowed with permission and with help with phrasing from the LGBT task force, their annual conference, Creating Change. And, the idea is basically just that bathrooms are available to anyone, for anybody who needs to use it. It's the same stuff in all the bathrooms. Some of them you can use standing, and some of them you have to sit. But in any case, it's just a bathroom, and anybody who wants to use it can use it.
How'd that go over? I mean, even in the free thought culture, how did that go over? Did you get some pushback? Did everybody go for it?
At first, some people weren't quite sure how to deal with that. But frankly, the first time you go in there and, you know, you see some people who identify differently than the way you identify, for 30 seconds, you're like, this is different. But then you're like, well, they're here to use the bathroom and I'm here to use the bathroom and we're all adults here and whatever. And you just use the bathroom and nobody, it's not that big of a deal. It's like a water fountain, you know. A long time ago, there used to be segregated water fountains and then there weren't. And people thought it was weird at first and then they got used to it. It's really not that big of a deal.
No more men's restrooms, no more women's restrooms. It's just the restroom. Is that the goal? Is that what we want?
Well, some people don't like that quite as much. Personally, I prefer to use women's restrooms. That's my preference because I identify as a woman, and it helps affirm that for me. It helps confirm my gender identity to use a women's room. But if the most practical solution is non-segregated, inclusive bathrooms that anybody can use, I think that's a concept that is definitely worth people grasping, is this issue of segregation. We've done this before in civil rights activism of helping people understand that it's not healthy to segregate things like that, and it's not useful, and it helps everybody to not segregate.
You guys been following the Target story at all?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes.
Anybody want to spell it out for the listeners?
Basically, Target stores have decided to stop separating their toy sections into sections of toys for girls and sections of toys for boys, with the idea that if a child wants to play with a toy, it doesn't really matter what organs they have. There's two types of toys. There's toys that you operate with your genitals, and those are not for children. And there's toys that you don't operate with your genitals, and those are for all children. Target only sells one of those two categories anyway. So it really doesn't make too much of a difference, and there's no reason to separate them. And it enforces gender stereotypes and encourages bullying, which Target does not want to do. So they've elected to discontinue doing that.
So they're still carrying the G.I. Joes and the Barbies and whatever, but they're just not putting boys, girls, these signs hanging over them and cordoning the different genders of children off to their respective sections of the toy department. Is that it?
That's my understanding.
I don't understand why people are so threatened by that. I mean, I identified as a girl from the time that I was like 10 or so, and I still liked playing with G.I. Joes and Transformers and Ninja Turtles and stuff like that. And I had cis girlfriends who liked the same things. Like, and I don't honestly understand what is so threatening to people about that.
It may betray a tremendous insecurity. You know, when I was growing up, it was always, everything was a test of manhood, right? And if I was talking about this with Dr. Ray a few weeks ago, we were talking about male shaming and shaming of both genders, actually, and how if they were going to insult you as a man in the locker room, they would call you a female attribute. They would just pick some sort of a female driven slur. And so everything was your attempt to reinforce the masculine gender. You know, you've got to work out more. You got to be stronger. You've got to talk tougher. You've got to do boy things, you know, that kind of thing. And it almost seems rather conspicuous. Is it insecurity? Are they masking perhaps some sexual questions they might have in their own minds and lives? I don't know.
This is Zinnia. What interests me here is this idea that gender norms of which toys are for boys, which toys are for girls, boys do this, girls do that. What interests me is that they seem to think that these have to be enforced, that they have to be policed, they have to be taught. And this goes against another major assumption in play here, which is that these things are innate. I mean, if these are innate and these are just, you know, inherent tendencies of boys and girls that supposedly differ so much as to warrant, you know, separate categorization for toys, then what need is there to police this or teach this? I mean, what would be lost with the absence of these signs? I mean, if everyone supposedly just knows innately what's for boys and what's for girls, then what need is there for this signage? The supposed need to police this just does really show how insecure about this so many people are. They feel that this is something that has to be shored up because whatever exists innately is apparently just insufficient for them.
How much of this is religiously motivated? You know, let's say I'm a young kid. If my mom or dad had walked in and I was playing with, you know, Barbie's Easy Bake Oven, which was awesome, by the way. Cookies were delicious. If they'd walked in and seen me playing with feminine, quote-unquote feminine toys, you know, things with pink and flowers and whatever on them, you know, the stuff my twin sister had been playing with, they would have flipped out. I mean, they would have grabbed the toys and they would have absconded to the toy box and they would have probably brought me something else. And I suspect part of that has to do with the fact that they are hugely religious and therefore use their religion, their belief in the Christian God and the Christian Bible, to define healthy human sexuality. Is there any merit to that?
I'd like to answer this one. This is Danielle. I think that, well, first of all, there is trans misogyny among people who are atheists. Let's not deny that. You don't have to be religious to not get trans issues or to be against transgender people and bigoted towards trans people. But I do believe very strongly that the motivation for a lot of trans hate is religion, specifically Judeo-Christian ideas and puritanical ideas about gender roles, and that this is very much reinforced in especially, you know, Protestant Christianity as it's practiced in the United States. And I think that science is descriptive. It's not proscriptive. It doesn't tell us the way things are supposed to be. It tells us the way things are. And it is very little of a problem for somebody who trusts science to look at what science is learning about the way the world actually is and adjust their thinking in order to reflect what we're learning. It is very, very difficult for somebody who does not trust science and somebody further who trusts the Bible to change their thinking based on what science is learning about gender, especially if that conflicts with what they're told is the way things are supposed to be prescriptively. And I think that's really the problem with this and the root of this. And we see this with all sorts of other issues too, besides just trans issues. But, you know, I think that's really the deep down source of this, in this country, at least, this hatred against trans people, is that it goes against this biblical, puritanical idea of God created a man and a woman, and together in a heteronormative relationship there to have children, and that's the purpose of the sexes and the purpose of sex and the purpose of identification as a man or a woman at all.
Anybody else?
Yeah, I think, and I've actually heard Daryl Ray talk about this on his show with attitudes about sex, but I think it carries over into gender too. I think even when we talk about when we see bigotry against trans people among people who are non-believers, I think those may still in large ways be leftover ideas about gender and sexuality that came from religion, but people don't necessarily recognize that. They leave the Bible is the word of God behind, but some of the attitudes about gender and sex they keep because they haven't really thought that far into it to understand that that's where those attitudes actually originate from.
Stephanie, you've been on the front lines of activism along with the rest of us. Have you seen discrimination? Have you seen misogyny? Have you seen bigoted attitudes toward trans people within this supposedly enlightened culture of non-believers?
Check the comments on my YouTube channel.
What are they saying?
Probably my one, a couple of my favorites were ones I responded to and posted. One of them said, $20, she has a dick.
Do you respond to these or do you just let it go?
I do. To that one, I responded, $30, you want it. I'm just making an easy $50.
Well, I've always said that the YouTube comment section is, you know, is where discourse goes to die, right? It's, if there is a hell, it is the YouTube comment section.
I view it as target practice.
It's therapeutic to a degree. I'll go in and respond occasionally to someone who's saying something that's just hugely wrongheaded or at least compelling in some way. I totally understand. Do you ever get somebody whose mind has changed on the YouTube comment section? Do you ever make headway?
I haven't had anyone. Actually, no, I have. I've had a couple people ask some questions, and I've responded to them and in clearing stuff up for them. I've also had people clear stuff up for me. I've had some of my subscribers go at other people in the comments and correct them. So it's been kind of fun to watch that as well.
I see quite often this kind of, I hesitate to even bring this up when the word feminism is thrown out. I see the comment section explode and everybody is, they're not even speaking. They're just shouting. And I'm guessing the entire panel identifies as a feminist in some way.
Very much so.
Definitely.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And yep. I define feminism. You know, we're talking about equality of the genders and whatnot. I'm amazed at how there simply is no discourse on this anymore at all. Nobody's talking. Everybody's shouting. And I don't really understand what drives that. Do you have any thoughts on that? And, you know, now that you identify as a woman, does it relate even more to you and the desire for equality?
This is Callie. The answer to that question is another word that makes comment sections explode, and that word is privilege. I always tell people who say, like, you know, male privilege doesn't exist, talk to a trans woman who transitions, you know, somewhere in the middle of life, who at one time had it and then lost it in transition. And what an amazingly jarring experience that is, or at least has been for me. A lot of times it's not even malicious. It's a blindness, because these are things that so many people just never have to consider in their daily lives.
Anybody else?
This is Zinnia. One thing I've noticed is that my videos express so many overtly feminist themes, just without using the word necessarily, because that just seems to shut people's brains down. But if people actually pay attention, they'll notice that I'm endorsing all sorts of very mainstream feminist goals. Things like just reducing the influence of gender norms, not just policing, you know, what women can and can't do, things like that. And I definitely agree with Callie. I mean, this is the sort of thing that you can learn firsthand. I mean, there was a time when, due to a lack of experience, you know, I wasn't clear why men would start talking to me when I was checking out at Walmart, you know, but contrary to what that often shared Facebook post from the beginning of the show said, believe me, we learn quickly.
I was having this conversation with my dad probably a few weeks ago. I had been walking home from somewhere and I was noticing all these guys turning their heads while driving. And I had this funny thought, like, because it gets kind of annoying, because getting catcalled and things like that, it just gets old. No matter how affirming it is, it gets really annoying. And I kind of had this little temporary fantasy where it'd be, oh, you know, it would be fun to cause an accident just because some guy was staring at me. And I was talking to my dad, and he said, you know, didn't you used to do that when you were a teenager? And I said, you know, I really didn't, even though there was like peer pressure to do so, simply because I wasn't interested in, I'm straight, by the way, this is important for the story. I'm not into women in that way. So it never occurred to me to actually act that way. So as far as that part, there are things even about being a man that I still don't understand. And I don't know. I think that's interesting. There's some things I know, but there's things I'm completely, I'm just as foreign to them, say, as any other cis girl.
Danielle?
I have never, ever wanted to catcall a woman, much less actually done that. I actually have been catcalled too, but that is also something that is puzzling to me about why people do that. Almost always men, but
like, has there ever been a female who said, "Awesome," turned on a dime, and went home with whoever was whistling or shouting at him? Is that in the history of humankind ever happened once? I just am curious.
Not from my knowledge. I do want to say, though, I present as a man right now, and I would like to change that in the future when I have health insurance and I'm able to take more steps toward that. But right now, the only time that I'm really treated differently by people who don't know me, I should say, is online. And on Twitter, for example, my Twitter handle is just at Danielle Muscato, so it's, you know, very clearly feminine. And I have a cartoon drawing of a feminine version of what I actually look like. So it's not a photo. So as far as anybody who looks at my Twitter page knows, I'm just a cis woman. And I've noticed since I changed my handle and since I changed my picture, I get corrected a lot more. A lot of people, like, they'll correct my grammar or they'll correct something factual about what I said, and they'll put like a little link at the end of it. It's always men. And I don't mind being corrected. I actually appreciate that. But what bothers me is that they're not always right. Like, often when people correct me, they're incorrect. And this never used to happen with my old name. And especially, like, something else that I've noticed that happens now that never used to happen before is I'll make a joke. I'll say something sarcastic or something kind of underhanded as far as not like a subtle joke, a very not obvious joke. And guys will tweet back at me spelling out the joke like they thought of that. And that never used to happen before either. And it's made me realize more some of these kinds of subtle things about the way that men talk to women. And I don't think that they're doing it on purpose. I think that's just how they're used to talking to women without really noticing that they do that, without really thinking about it. It's not malice. It's just they're used to thinking of women as not as smart or not as funny, and don't really know what to do with that.
I've seen a lot of it in the workplace. I've seen on the tennis court. Hey there, little lady. Come over here. Let me give you a few pointers, and we'll show you how this is going to be done. All right. I mean, it's just this kind of chest thumping. Let me give you a piece of my strength kind of a deal, you know?
Exactly. And as far as making mistakes, I wanted to come back to something that you said at the beginning of the show, actually, where you talked about how you're learning about this and you hope that nobody, you know, negatively judges you for saying the wrong thing.
I'm terrified of screwing up, Danielle, is the truth. I just don't want to screw up.
This is something that I want to help you understand and help anybody listening understand that that's okay. This is something that we understand that you're learning. And as long as your intentions are good and you're making a bona fide effort not to hurt people, we're not going to bite your head off. I mean, it is important to actually make a bona fide effort. I don't want people to think that they don't have to try because they can count on us not caring. It's not that we don't care. Of course we care about this stuff. That's why we do activism. That's why we write these you know, guides to LGBT, you know, language to help people get it right. But I wasn't born knowing this stuff. I just happened to be trans. And the way that I learned is by exploring this stuff, teaching myself, reading as much as I could find, in order to, and it's the same thing about how if you have atheist friends, if you respect atheists, even if you're not an atheist, you are going to teach yourself what atheism is, what atheism isn't, you know, what all of this type of stuff in an effort to be more accommodating and respectful of people that you know who are atheists. And I think it's just the same thing. If you have trans friends or if you just want to be, you know, accepting of trans people, it's not a bad idea to take some time and teach yourself about how this works, to ask questions as long as you're not bothering somebody. It is easy to get worn out answering these types of questions over and over. But there are resources online where you can learn this stuff properly. You mentioned GLAAD at the beginning of the episode. That's a great resource. We're not angry about people getting these things wrong. We want you to get them right, and we're going to help you to the extent that we have time and energy for it. But don't feel bad about making mistakes. That's how you learn.
I want to come back to something that was brought up just a moment ago. You see the glance from somebody else's car window. You see somebody staring an extra few seconds. You see someone who is male or identifies as male who is interested in you as a female. And they get close enough to you and your life and the details of you to realize that you are a transgender female. Does that attraction go away? Do they shut down and move on? And what happens next?
I've had this happen multiple times in the last 2 months, to be honest. And it's extremely hurtful. There was a guy on OkCupid that, you know, had messaged me. We were getting along really well, and it was really awesome. By the way, on my OkCupid profile, it says very clearly I'm a trans woman. If you don't like it, move along. He had read everything else about me and apparently completely missed that. So the day before, the day we're supposed to go on a date, I was like, you know, it's probably a good idea for me to tell him now, because I don't think he knows, or at least I'm not getting the sense that he knows. And it turns out I was right. He didn't have any idea. And he ditched me. He just completely shut me out. I haven't heard from him since.
Do you feel a responsibility? I mean, do you feel like you have a responsibility to, because this, does it speak to attraction? You know, you're not just a female. You were a female who once identified as a male and had male genitalia. This is relevant to somebody who is also operating in the arena of attraction. Do you feel you have an obligation to say, I am a trans woman, to say not, trans in front of woman?
Not in the sense that it's, let me put it this way. I don't feel responsible to them. I only do it for my own safety. I don't want them to find out and trans panic harm me, if that makes sense. It's a completely selfish reason why I tell them. It has nothing to do with wanting them to know. I couldn't care any less if they knew or not. But in the event that the relationship were to get intimate, I don't want to be harmed. So I'd rather them know and ditch me than end up in a body bag.
Anybody else want to handle the responsibility question? Is it relevant, and do you feel an obligation to inform anybody and everybody else that you once identified as another gender?
Yeah, this is Callie. It's a really complicated thing because obviously me being trans is a big part of my life. I mean, it's, you know, I do that activism and it's informed so much of my life experience, but it's not all I am. I'm a Star Trek nerd and, you know, all of these other things. So if I meet somebody, especially in a real life situation, if we're not on a dating site or something like that, I don't want to introduce myself. Hi, I'm Callie Wright. By the way, I'm transgender. but if I don't do that and this person turns hostile when they find out, if, you know, things start to get intimate before the conversation turns that way. I mean, I know people who have had physical violence perpetrated on them from situations like that. So you don't want to open up with it as if this is the thing that is me, but you can't leave it out either for those reasons. So there's always this conflict going on, at least for me in my head, when I'm talking to people in that dynamic, like, I don't want them to think that's the only thing about me that matters, but I also have to think about my safety, like Stephanie was saying.
Anybody else?
This is Zinnia, and for me, the situation's somewhat different because I don't get into relationships with men, so that's not really a factor for me. And I have a huge trans symbol tattooed on my chest, so it's not like something that I'm hiding. But in my experience, it's been somewhat more from a distance, because I get bombarded by thousands upon thousands of unsolicited comments from men over time. And given that they see me as a woman, they feel compelled to just offer their views on whether I am attractive or not, because they must think that I want to hear that, as if I care. And one of the most interesting things about that is the dichotomy that emerges there. There will be men who feel, for whatever reason, a need to tell me that I'm like somehow very attractive or beautiful or something like that, which, okay, whatever. But then there are also men who feel compelled to use anti-trans slurs and declare that I am just hideously ugly and so on. And it's interesting to think how these two things can coexist. How can people look at, you know, the same person, one of them considers me, you know, extremely attractive by, I suppose, conventionally feminine standards, however they apply those, and the other just thinks I'm basically monstrous. And so what you see here is that these expressions of attraction or the lack thereof, these aren't necessarily what they seem to be. These are things that can serve like more as a proxy for moral judgment. They're not really expressing, you know, an evaluation of my appearance. They're expressing an opinion of who and what I am as a trans woman.
There are some misconceptions I saw on a website. I was just doing my own homework before the show, and several different websites are talking about the things people get wrong about what trans is and isn't. I'll just throw a few of these out. Anybody who wants to comment can, okay? Everybody who is trans is obviously trans.
This is Danielle. I mean, like I said, there's really not a good way to tell that somebody is trans except for asking them anyway. Okay. It's not something that you can tell by looking at somebody. I don't look trans. I don't, if there is such a thing as looking trans, and no one would know if I didn't say something. Until I changed my name and came out publicly, only my friends who I told in, you know, in confidence knew. And some trans people don't do anything physically to transition, or don't even change the way that they dress or start wearing makeup or anything. So it's definitely a myth. You cannot tell if someone is trans by looking at them.
I saw it written somewhere that trans people are just, quote, extra gay. Anybody want to tackle that one?
I can answer this one if you'd like. This is Danielle again. I am gay. I'm attracted to women. But it's not an extra gay thing. I mean, whatever that means, you can be more exclusively attracted to one gender or another gender. But this is actually a very serious civil rights and human rights issue in certain countries that compel transitioning for religious reasons. There are some Middle Eastern countries where being gay is absolutely a capital offense, very, very much wrong by their culture. But being transgender is not. And so people are very heavily pressured or compelled to transition because they're gay, because that makes them in line with what their religion teaches. If you're gay, you can be a trans woman and then you can be with men. But you can't be gay and be with another man. Important that people understand that there is a difference between being a trans woman and being gay. It's not a superlative form of the former. There's two different things, and this is a human rights violation to confuse them.
Anybody else?
This is Zinnia, and I think a lot of people need to realize that there's actually a diversity of sexual orientations among trans women, just like there's a diversity of sexual orientations among cis women. In some ways, more so of straight trans women in a lot of studies, you know, trans women who are attracted to men are often in a minority. So this notion of just all trans women just having this background that they were just originally, you know, assumed to be extremely gay men who are very attracted to men isn't really reflected by the numbers. There are a substantial portion of trans women who are attracted to women, which does make them actually gay. And that can be up to 40% or more in various studies. So that particular accounting for, you know, the origin of trans women based on that one sexual orientation is oversimplified and not empirically supported.
Does the recent ruling of the Supreme Court affect trans people specifically?
Yes, very much so, because so many of us are queer identified in one way or the other. And one thing that I've talked about before is in Ohio, where I live, I cannot have my birth certificate amended to say female. When I change my name and all that sort of stuff, they basically just staple a piece of paper to the back of it. So before the Supreme Court ruled, because my driver's license says female, my birth certificate says male, I didn't know actually who it was legal for me to marry. And, I'm generally speaking, I'm more attracted to women than I am men, but I enjoy both. And, for a while, it was me and, some of my trans friends were like, who actually can we marry? And we found out in a lot of ways, it's a judge's discretion. A judge literally gets to decide who we could marry until obviously the Supreme Court ruling. So, I mean, it was definitely a trans issue as well.
Anybody else?
I mean, just as Zinnia said, I'm in the minority here. I'm the only straight girl. Which I think is really interesting. But yeah, no, no, it is. Because Callie, I don't think I'm going to be wrong in saying this. Callie is probably, can I say bye, Callie? I don't want to put labels on.
By fits.
You don't want.
I'm still kind of on a journey, to be honest, to like figuring the whole thing out.
I'm just saying for brevity, let's say bye, gay, gay.
Straight. Right.
I have, since I started transitioning, I think what I said on Facebook is that I identify as flamboyantly straight. So,
that's a t-shirt, Stephanie.
Yes,
that's
it
a
is.
T-shirt. I am flamboyantly straight.
Yeah, I love me some boys. I love me all the boys. And I mean, it's the Supreme Court ruling, probably for the same reason that Callie was talking about, affected me similarly, only in a different way, obviously, that if I wanted to marry a guy, my birth certificate might have gotten in the way of that. So now I don't have to worry about it. So thank you, Supreme Court, for being on the correct side of history.
Speaking here with Zinnia Jones, who has a terrific YouTube page, Stephanie Guttormson of the Richard Dawkins Foundation, and Stinks Stephtically. I've got Callie Wright at the Gaytheist Manifesto and Danielle Muscato. Let's talk about the physical transition. And again, you determine where our threshold of comfort is here, okay? But we're talking about an intrusive, operative change of a physical body from one gender to another. It was called in the opening monologue in the article that I'd read from the National Review, mutilation, bodily mutilation.
This is Zinnia, and I think one of the important things here is that transitioning is not some set linear process of just an established sequence of steps that everyone follows in order to transition. It's not like that at all. People don't always choose to have the same procedures or treatments done. Some people want very many of them. Some people don't want many of them at all. People do them in different orders. Think of it like a cafeteria menu. People choose what suits them best. And that can be modulated by, ability to access this, via healthcare and just their financial situation and things like that. But the point is that this is not just something that's the same for everyone. There isn't just this fixed order of things. And, when you go from head to toe, there are like a dozen different procedures that can be done on so many different parts of the body. It differs for trans women, for trans men, for non-binary people, and it can include really just whatever anyone in particular wants. And not everyone wants to have all of that work done that people would, assume. Not everyone wants genital surgery. Not everyone wants facial reconstructive surgery. Not everyone wants breast augmentation or other procedures like that. It completely differs based on the individual and how they feel about their body and what they feel is necessary for them. So it's really important not to make assumptions about that.
This is Callie, and one of the things that I think is important, because we spend a lot of time fighting against this perception that, transition and being transgender is, specifically about sex and the ways in which that we have sex and the people we have sex with. But I mean, the fact is we're still human beings. You know, for most folks, sex is a basic human need. And when there's a disconnect between the neural map of your brain and the way that your body is physically made up, I think it's impossible to overstate the effect that can have on your intimate relationships with people. You know, as stated before, not everyone feels that disconnect, and people feel it to different degrees. I mean, some people don't like it, but don't hate it enough to have surgery. Some people it's crippling. Some people it's mild and, you know, flares up. That kind of describes me. But it's about making yourself comfortable in the body that you're in. It's not just this like, oh, I have to change my body because I hate it. It's a very, very basic, like, brain body match thing, if that makes sense.
Stephanie, did the lawsuit have anything to do with any of this, or was it a completely, totally unrelated thing, you and the faith healer? Did he come after you because you were trans, or was it something else? What happened?
All right, so I had made a... All right, let's start from the beginning. David Smalley sent me the video, the original video, and said, hey, you should talk about this on the show. And I said, you know, not only will I do that, but this is a great thing to make a video about. This guy's peddling some serious nonsense here. I made the video last year, like around November or December. Come around to April 2015, and he made a response video to me. He also had sent me a whole bunch of messages and threatening to sue me. In his response video, though, and I know Zinnia saw it and was fairly disgusted with it, he doc dropped me in the video right at the beginning, using my birth name. And he had a couple of his, I guess, clients, you can call them clients, a couple of the girls saying that because I was trans, I was lying about who I was and those kind of things. He filed the lawsuit under my birth name purposefully, which was really disrespectful, and we made his lawyers aware of that very quickly. But the fact that he came after me so hard and the way he came after me was interesting. He definitely used my being trans against me, or at least tried to.
Well, his name is Adam Miller.
Yes.
And was he a YouTube presence? Does he have an actual physical church somewhere, or what?
No, he had a practice that he ran out of his house, and maybe a couple of offices. His YouTube, Facebook, and website have since been down. They've been down since he dropped the lawsuit. He had a few claims that he sued me for. One, he sued me for copyright infringement, which of course didn't hold up because my use of his video was covered under fair use. He sued me for defamation of character, which wouldn't stand up because I never ad hominemed at any point. I was simply going after his claims about what he could do, and said that, no, you don't have magic powers. That was the only thing I said. He was claiming that the things I said in my videos, like con artist and charlatan, in the titles, were defamation. I pointed out in one of my videos that he fit the definition of a con artist and a charlatan because he was claiming he could do things that he couldn't. It's the very definition. The only way he could prove that it was defamation is to prove he had magic powers in a court of law. And then the other one was tortious interference with his business, which didn't hold up because I was, of course, just commenting on his claims.
I'm sure you guys have a huge amount of crossover traffic, a faith healer over here, and then the Think Stephtically YouTube channel. I'm sure there's tons of people bouncing back and forth to interfere with his business. That's just crazy. What's interesting to me, though, is the fact that you're Stephanie. Everywhere on the site, on the pages at Richard Dawkins, you're Stephanie and have been for a long time. And yet he had to have actually sought out your birth name in order to find it, correct?
That is correct. I mean, it would have been hard for him to do just because my last name is, as you know, extremely unique. But yeah, his docs dropping me, that took a little bit of work. At least he had to have the ire to do it, if that makes sense.
What else are we missing in these discussions? What else have I missed as a host, as an interviewer? What else do I and the audience need to understand? What would benefit us in the understanding of this very complex subject? Anything come to mind?
This is Zinnia, and one of the most frequent myths is that we somehow want to just bother or harass people in bathrooms. We actually don't. We want people to leave us alone in bathrooms and not harass us, and that's kind of incompatible with, you know, harassing people, committing sexual assaults, and so on. So really, we just want to be left alone when we go to the bathroom, please.
Yeah,
you have my word. All right.
No, there's this great meme someone sent me and says transgender people want to use the bathroom of their intended gender not to prey on your wives and kids. They just want to use it because they have to pee.
So this is a thing? I mean, you walk into the restroom and people flip out over this?
Legally, yeah. I mean, all these laws. I know. I think Zinnia, if I'm saying this wrong, let me know. But I think you're speaking more to the societal push to have laws that exclude us from using the gender of our, that we identify with, right?
Yeah, exactly. There have been so many of those proposed laws, which have, you know, not passed or anything, but have been proposed over the past year that are trying to regulate which bathrooms trans people can go into and usually misgender us totally, saying that trans women have to use the men's room, trans men have to use the women's room. And the irony of this is that that would be incredibly disruptive. I mean, even before I transitioned, there was a time when I used the men's room because that was just what I did back then. And some guy just confronts me and asks me if I'm a man or a woman. And that was actually the only time that I've had issues in public bathrooms. So these people seem to come at this from a very naive perspective of probably not knowing very many trans people personally and understanding that, you know, a visible woman walking into the men's room is going to be disruptive if you legally require that. That is going to cause far more chaos than they believe that they're mitigating.
This is Callie. And actually, Seth, when you were on my show, that was one of the things that I was talking about was a trans bathroom bill that they were trying to pass in Oklahoma. And to this day, the episode of my podcast that I've gotten the most response to was an episode that we did about trans bathroom bills. And what you see when you hear people talk about these things, you see that, you know, conservatives, I think, largely have kind of given up the fight when it comes to at least gay marriage, if not, you know, anti-discrimination laws and, you know, that kind of thing. And to kind of segue, like, the bathroom thing, I think, is part of a larger issue to where I think we are kind of the next target of people's efforts to stop progress. And what I don't think a lot of people understand, if we're talking about things that we haven't necessarily touched a whole lot on yet, is that transgender people largely are a very, very vulnerable population. We experience extremely disproportionately high levels of poverty, homelessness, exposure to violence, sexual assault. You know, basically every bad thing that can happen to a person, it is more likely to happen to you if you are trans. And I don't think a lot of people understand that because, you know, it's started to come more to the forefront, but largely until recently, we've kind of just been invisible. Not even that people were actively going after us, but we just weren't even really part of the conversation. And now that that's happening, there's a double-edged sword because there's this visceral reaction, this ridiculous pushback now that we're being more visible and coming more to the forefront and more standing up for ourselves. That's all good stuff, but it brings this backlash that a lot of people in our community aren't necessarily in a place to deal with. So we need allies desperately fighting for us too.
Anybody else?
What really bugs me, more than just bugs me, actually passionately angry about these bathroom bills is this. They're based on this presumption that trans people are sexual predators and or pedophiles, and neither of those are true. And, I mean, if somebody is going to have such a low moral standard and such little regard for the law that they're going to attack someone in the bathroom, a law requiring them to use the one gender bathroom or the other is not going to stop them. I mean, that's really not the problem we should be focusing on. If you want to make some kind of bathroom bill that's actually going to focus on this imaginary problem of people being attacked while they're using the bathroom, I would think that we should be more concerned about, like, convicted sex offenders using the same bathrooms as other people. I mean, that's really who we should be talking about if that's what you're worried about, right? But these same people have no inkling of this this thought that they should be addressing sex offenders using public bathrooms when, you know, even though these same people have to register and not be near schools and parks and so on, are not sexual predators. We are not pedophiles. And that's not just insulting, but it further stigmatizes us in the population that is already stigmatized and oppressed. It's not right, and I'm sick of it. And we are facing the same sorts of stigmatization that, you know, gay people saw in the 50s and 60s before people really understood that that was not a mental disorder, that that was not something to be ashamed of. And people just equated being gay with being a pervert, and that's not true. We just want to use the bathroom. This is not complicated.
You know, I know the atheist movement benefited in many ways from the hard road that the gay rights movement went down, you know, and we were able to borrow some. They had succeeded, but those successes have come on the heels of so many failures and so much, you know, blood in the streets and so much hate and discrimination, so many hard battles lost and won. And I know in the atheist culture, we've been able to benefit from that to help fight for the rights of non-believers, to help educate people about what non-belief is, what atheism is and isn't. Does that model work for trans to sort of make some inroads as far as the rights of transgender people?
I think there's definitely a lot to take from that, but I think a lot of people don't even understand that the fight is not even necessarily about things related to being trans. You know, there are stories of trans men. There's a trans man who had breast cancer, and the doctor decided to not call him with the cancer diagnosis because he was trans, because he didn't know how to handle it. Or a trans woman playing in an LGBT softball league whose insurance decided to not cover her broken arm because they said her playing in an LGBT softball league was part of her transition. So it's not even necessarily stuff having to do with us being trans. A lot of times these fights are about basic human needs like healthcare and basic healthcare, not even transition related healthcare. So I think that's an important thing to frame the conversation with, is that it's really about basic human needs as well as all of the things that go specifically along with being transgender.
DJ, anything?
I would agree with what Callie said about how much of this is really based on so many foundations of things that apply to everyone. So many aspects of, you know, what trans people face are just things that everyone else would deal with, but in the case of trans people, it's treated as somehow, you know, out of bounds or as something new or something unacceptable. Like using the bathroom. Everyone has to go to the bathroom, but in this case, this is treated as just something that can be completely discounted and forgotten about and overly policed. And in terms of healthcare and things like that, I've faced healthcare companies where I've just, after I got insurance, I ended up having to pay more for my blood tests than when I was paying out of pocket because they were now charging the insurance company's rate, and then the insurance company refused to pay any of it, which then bounced it back to me. So that actually put me at a net disadvantage there until I could actually convince them to cover these blood tests, which they would be doing for any other woman who was, say, on hormone therapy, just as part of a basic health checkup, as part of the maintenance of that. And on so many levels, this is not an issue of, say, special treatment, as, you know, so many social conservatives would try to make it out to be, as if we're some privileged minority. We're not. These are just things that are applicable to everyone else, often respected in the case of everyone else, or at least should be, and yet for us are being withheld without reason.
ZJ, what do we want? What's the end zone? Do we want a society with no men or women sign above any of the doors, no men or women's clothing sections? Do we want to make gender irrelevant?
I consider this to be a matter of self-determination, as in people should have the freedom to choose, you know, what sort of presentation is right for them, what gender they express they feel is right for them, and things like that. And in terms of things that obstruct that, things like labels saying only women do this, only men do that, only women wear this, only men wear that, if those are meant to be imposed upon people to decide, you know, because of your gender, this is the limited set of what you can do, that is something that I feel should be obsolete in whatever form it takes. I am not against gender or the existence of gender or the expression of gender. I'm against the policing of gender. I'm against the enforcement of these gender norms on people who don't want to have these gender norms forced upon them. Why should it be anyone else's place to say that, you know, because you're a man or because you're a woman, you can't do that. But if you were a woman or a man instead, then suddenly it becomes okay to do that. There is no reason for us to have to work within that framework of restrictions, and that's definitely something that should be done away with.
Danielle, anything to add?
I think something that needs to be addressed is that I think a lot of people seem to consider this LGBTQ fight kind of over, in that the United States Supreme Court already ruled on marriage equality, and that was the big fight, and now we have equality, and it's really not that simple. I know that a lot of LGBTQ organizations are suffering enormous drops in donor revenue right now because people consider this fight to be done, but I want people to consider that this fight is really just beginning. That was the first milestone. I mean, there have been many, but that was one of the first major milestones for rights for queer people. And the next big fight, I think, is trans rights. And people need to understand that, you know, if you're a straight trans person, with the exception of some identification document type issues, that Supreme Court ruling had no bearing on you. Unless you happen to also be gay, or unless you happen to live in a state where these very specific paperwork problems come up, gay people being able to marry each other wasn't something that you were fighting for. It's not your fight. And a lot of the time, I think trans rights get lumped into gay rights because they're all fighting for recognition, because we're all fighting stigma. But it's really a separate type of issue. It's not really the same type of thing. And I think I want to encourage people to continue to donate to organizations fighting for those types of rights, and understand that that was the first thing. The second thing that I want to say is that being transgender is extremely difficult for a lot of people before they transition, if they choose to transition, deciding to transition, transitioning, and then living as someone who has transitioned. It's not an easy life to live. And you face high unemployment, you face violence, you face other types of things that we've talked about on this call. And the suicide rate for trans people is very high compared to the general population, something like 8 times as high. And you can call the National Lifeline, you know, hotline to talk about this stuff. But I want people to know that there actually is a trans hotline for people who are trained to talk about these issues more specifically and to relate to you and help you with those types of resources too. That number in the United States is 877-565-8860, or you can go to translifeline.org. And don't be afraid to call that if you have questions or if you need to talk to somebody, because that is a specialized type of conversation, and suicide is not the solution.
You've used a word that Callie used earlier in the broadcast, queer. Is it a word that is being embraced and taken back, or?
It's a term that has been reclaimed, and it's kind of the preferred term, or becoming the preferred term as an umbrella word, especially for a younger generation of activists.
I actually, you know, if that conversation comes up, I mean, primarily I just say I am a transgender and queer woman, because queer to me is kind of an umbrella term for anything that's not heterosexual. And what's important to know about sexuality is that it's not only a spectrum, but sometimes it's fluid too. I mean, attractions skew one way or the other. They're not exclusive. It's there's a spectrum of space in between that. And I think using the word queer better reflects that than saying like, I'm either 100% straight, 100% gay, or completely in the middle, which obviously there's nothing wrong with any of those things, but that those three things don't describe everyone either. So I've taken to just using queer as an umbrella term.
You know, I have to look back and think about my own life, my own upbringing, and how that, you know, when I was being raised with these hugely clumsy definitions about healthy human sexuality based on the Christian Bible, you know, based on the writings of people who didn't really know much about anything, and yet they were truth, they were beyond reproach, beyond question. When I saw so much bigotry practiced in the name of religious belief, sacred religious belief. You know, if we'd been at a public place and a trans person had walked up next to us, my mother might have just scooted us all off to quote-unquote safety. And then she would have maybe given us a sermon or lecture about how this is a perversion of God's beautiful model for healthy sexuality, and they are this, and they are that, and keep your distance, maybe even be afraid. I don't know. But it would have been a culture, an attitude of fear, certainly an attitude of ignorance. And instead of wanting to know more about it, I think we would have just kept our distance and looked at the transgender subject from afar, never really understanding. And here I am decades later as a free thinker, as an atheist, someone who's liberated from these narrow walls of sacred, quote unquote, sacred religious belief. And I'm able to ask the questions and discover the beauty of beautiful people who are not like me, and so what? And I can stand alongside them and fight for a world where they don't have to live their lives under the boot of discrimination or bigotry or fear. And their lives can be celebrated as they should be. And we can foster a better understanding of what healthy and diverse human sexuality is. For your time, for your perspective, and for sharing so much of your personal story tonight on the radio, I just have to say thanks. It's been a real honor to have you on the radio.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
It's awesome to be part of your journey.
I'd like to close the broadcast with a letter that I received from Celia. Now, the letter is a bit long. I can't share all of it on the broadcast tonight, so I'll synopsize certain segments of it. But I thought the letter was an interesting one, and I felt it might provide a great cap to the show tonight. Celia said, I was born into this world as a boy to a socially conservative Christian couple who immigrated from South Korea to the United States. I was born here. I was raised most of the time in South Korea until my parents brought us back to Oregon when I was 5. I've been transgender and have always wanted to be a girl and closely identified myself as a female for as long as I could remember. Way back as a 3 or 4 year old growing up in the countryside of the South Korean capital of Seoul, at the time neither the English word nor the Korean word for transgender registered in my toddler vocabulary. In fact, there is no Korean word for transgender. The Korean language borrows that word from English. Even the concept of transgender could not have possibly registered into my toddler mindset. However, even at the age of 3, I could tell I was different from the other boys. Average little boys in Korea are not that different from the average little boys in America. They love sports, video games, and action figures that resemble anything close to Star Wars or G.I. Joes. You could say the same thing about the similarities between American girls and Korean girls. However, I knew I was different from the other boys. Unlike other boys, I didn't like playing aggressively. And if my childhood memory serves me right, I enjoyed playing with the girls more than playing with the boys. And then she recounts a story about how she used to pretend to nurse a baby doll, and at one point even simulated childbirth, taking a doll and sticking it under her shirt and then pulling it out and grunting and yelling like she was in labor. One of her grandparents heard the commotion, came in and asked what was going on, and then actually assisted in the childbirth. The letter continues. Now, the thing that bothered me the most when I was growing up in South Korea and the U.S. as a child, and still bothers me to this day as an adult, were my male genitals. Growing up in Korea as a child, I remember feeling uncomfortable, having a sausage and walnuts. And yes, I called my penis and testicles sausage and walnuts because that's what they looked like to my child mind. And this discomfort grew more intense as I grew older. So intense to a point by the time I reached 6 or 7 to 9 or 10 years old, I'd often fantasize about cutting off my genitals. The only thing that stopped me from cutting was the thought of the resulting pain. As I look back as an educated adult now, I know there would have been complications like infections, excessive bleeding that could have killed me. And modern sex reassignment surgery techniques actually use the remaining parts of the penis and scrotum and fashion them into a remarkably realistic clitoris, vagina, and the labius. There are video documentations of this surgery on YouTube for educational purposes. Anyway, by the time I was 10, this was when the idea that I was a girl born in a boy's body began to solidify in my mind. But the seed of curiosity about my unique condition was planted. Didn't start to bud until 8th grade and freshman year in high school. It all made perfect sense to me. And then Celia goes on to explain why she liked wearing girls' clothing, girls' panties, short skirts. Incredibly comfortable, quote, incredibly comfortable and natural for me to wear. It also helped me make sense of my longing to grow out my hair and consequently my hatred of getting haircuts. When I was between 10 and 11, I began to feel the effects of puberty where male hormones were poisoning, her word, poisoning my body. By 13, I began experiencing some anxiety over my body, which is not uncommon. But for me, my bodily anxiety was stemming from the fact my body was beginning to exhibit male secondary sex characteristics when I wanted the female one instead. Thoughts like, why was my voice deepening like the tall boy in my gym class when I want a soft voice like the girl in my math class? Why can't I grow breasts like all the other girls in my school? I want breasts just like them, so bad. Thoughts like these were invading my mind. Even to this day, whenever I see pictures of, for example, Kim Kardashian, I find that I can't help myself from thinking it would be so awesome if I had breasts like those or a body like that when I see a bikini model. Following year, I entered freshman year in high school. The year was 2001. That was when our household subscribed to the internet for the first time, which I'd already learned to use in school since 6th grade. I was already familiar with how to use search engines like Google, Yahoo, etc. And it was at this time when the seeds of my curiosity about my transgender condition began to bud. And with the internet at my fingertips, I began to research my condition at home, starting with a simple Google search. And hilariously, I don't know how this happened, but the first result I stumbled upon was the transsexual-themed pornographic website, where it had erotic photographs of models who'd appear to be women with penises, with all kinds of slang terminologies I later learned were derogatory as I matured. Now, of course, porn, obviously, does not offer educational values under any academic standards, especially for me as a 14-year-old transgender girl who's trying to explore herself and discover her true identity. But if this encounter had left any positive lasting impressions on my 14-year-old self, I'd say this. It's when I discovered there were terminologies that precisely described my condition. Words like transsexual and transgender began flooding my vocabulary and creating even greater curiosity about my condition. It was also at this time when I realized my transgender condition, while rare, isn't unique. I remember reading an English language magazine about contemporary Korean culture in which I found two articles in separate issues about a South Korean transgender pop singer and an all-transgender girl band who stirred a sensation along with controversy in the South Korean media. I realized I wasn't alone as I was becoming more enlightened about my transgender identity. And naturally, it bore seed of curiosity in me about LGBT as a whole. I knew people who were gay. They were my classmates in school. And more personally, during my high school year, I discovered I was bisexual. But being a Christian and an active youth group member of my church, I was constantly preached about the sins of being LGBT. Scripture verses like Leviticus 18:22, 20:15, Romans 1:26 and 27, Deuteronomy 22:5 were being beaten into my head. Now, this did not stop me from learning more about myself as a transgender and bisexual woman, but it did create confusion and turmoil in my mind as I finally accepted myself as transgender and bisexual in my freshman and sophomore year of college. For the first time in my life, I bought myself some makeup, dresses, skirts, lingerie like bras and panties. I've never felt so liberated. And I feel really good even to this day when people refer to me using she or her pronouns. However, reconciling my transgender identity and my bisexual orientation with my Christian faith was nothing but an ongoing struggle and caused nothing but depression, stress, and grief. How will I come out to my Christian parents? What will they say? What will they do to me? And because no matter how much I tried to reconcile my condition with my faith, I was only discouraged by my Christian faith from being the beautiful, happy woman I wanted to be. I cried over this every night. Then the worst happened. In the fall of 2008, when my mom was going through my things and she found my bra and my makeup, she outed me. She was beyond livid. She was mortified. And it's ironic because this was the woman who bought me the Pocahontas cake for my 8th birthday. She got extremely emotional, just slamming scripture along with anger and fear, going all fire and brimstone about how my transgender identity and dreams of being a beautiful, happy woman was an act of rebellion against Yahweh, and how Yahweh will send me to hell if I don't repent and change my ways. Fortunately, I was able to recover and recollect myself from the horrific experience of that night. It took me 2 years to recover. But the one thing I never fully recovered was my Christian faith. The experience from that night with my mom put a huge dent on my Christian faith, which only continued to crack and then collapsed as I discovered science, reason, and then atheism and humanism. And now I happily and proudly accept myself as an atheist, humanist, bisexual, transgender woman. Thank you so much, Seth, for all you do. When I'm surrounded by religion of my family, the thinking atheist has been an amazing voice and a beacon of reason and hope to me. Yours truly, Celia. And Celia, thank you so much for the kind words, and thank you for sharing your story on the broadcast today. And that's going to do it for us tonight. Thanks so much again for listening and being a part of the broadcast. Next Tuesday, again, we're talking about the butterfly effect. Going to be some very cool stories on the show next week. Looking forward to that one. Thanks again to our show sponsor. It's Nature Box, with over 100 fun, delicious, and healthy snacks delivered right to your doorstep. And of course, if you haven't tried them before, your first box is on them. So check it out. Log on to naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. naturebox.com/thinkingatheist.
Follow The Thinking Atheist on Facebook and Twitter. Watch dozens of original videos on The Thinking Atheist YouTube channel. And visit our website for resources, links, contact information, the editor's blog, and more. TheThinkingAtheist.com.